Okay, this is my very first live stream, so I hope everything goes okay. I th think I crossed all the T's and dotted all the I's, but I'm not sure. And I do have a thunderstorm that may be going overhead, so that I might get disconnected or cut off. But today I was going to be doing a pencil sketch of Emma Watson. And here's the source photo that I'm going to be using. And this has always been one of my favorite photos that I've seen of Emma Watson. And it just looks like it just needs to be turned into a pencil sketch, as you can see. It just kind of has that look. And this is when she first got her hair cut, actually. Let's see. I don't know if you can tell from there, but I did put in some tick marks, a few tick marks, just to kind of act as guidelines so I can kind of block in the overall image, so that way I don't accidentally cut off her head. Let's see. Here, what I did, I used this caliper here, which is one of my favorite devices that I bought recently. Let's see. And what I did was, it's basically 11 centimeters, her head. So I'm kind of doubling up on everything. So that's about 11 centimeters there. And so I just doubled that up, and so it would be 22 centimeters. And I don't normally do that, but for this demonstration, I wanted to just make sure I got everything blocked in right. So that way, normally I would just start with the eyes and work my way out, and I'd have enough paper around the subject. But you see here how tight it is, and I wanted to kind of maintain that tight cropping. And so I just wanted to make sure that I don't accidentally run out of paper and, cut her head off, or cut off her lower portion, or one side of her face. So let's see. And here's a bigger. I'll also be looking at that. So for fine detail, I often like to have both a small picture and a large one, so that way this kind of gives me if I step back further and get a bird's eye view of it, and then the other one is closer up. And sometimes I'll even blow up one even larger than that, just for really fine detail. Looks like the video is lagging a little bit, but we'll proceed, and hopefully it all is good enough. Oh, and here's the paper that I'm using, if you can see that. This one's Strathmore for colored pencil, but it can also be used for pencil sketches. Sometimes they specify sketching paper or charcoal paper, but and it's 400 series, which is better than the 300 series, if you're wondering. And I can't remember if they have a 200. I do believe they have a 500 series. And sometimes it depends on, how thick you want the paper, the texture. So like they'll say fine-toothed or smooth. Sometimes you want it to be a little rough though, if you're working with colored pencils, so that way you can do multiple layers and it kind of grabs the pigment off the pencil. Because if it's too smooth, and it'll end up not grabbing onto your pencil and accepting the graphite. Sometimes I like to have a pad to actually cushion while I draw, but I think I'm gonna go ahead and put that off. And then if it starts to feel weird, I'll put it back. And I don't know if you can see the few tick marks that I put. I just wanted a few, just to know the top of her head, the bottom of her head, and kind of where her eyes were. And sometimes people, and including me, if it's an action shot, a scene that has a lot of action in it, or I'm completely making it up, I'll do, a real rough, sketch lines to kind of zero in on what it is I'm going to create. So it's almost like a scaffolding, a rough, And I always use a light pencil, by the way. I'm going to be using, you know, a series of pencils here. And I always start out with the lighter pencil, which is the harder lead. You know, the harder the lead, the lighter the tone. And later on, I'll gradually build up to softer leads, which are darker toned. So this way, the reason why is because these are just supposed to be like guidelines, and they are easier to erase if you make a mistake. So let me go ahead and, in fact, let me see if I can quickly show you, right quick, the scale here. Pencil grading scale. Yeah, there it is. And you can see it starts out at 9H, which means, you know, hard. And then it goes all the way to 9B, and they actually go a little higher than that. And I don't know what the B stands for. You know, you would think it would be S for soft, but it's not. I think I started out with H, which is hard. You know, you don't really need to get, you know, super light, but, you know, you can. Let me get back to where I was. Okay. There we are. So I'm going to just go ahead and, you know, normally is I start off with the eyes, and I usually start off with the right eye, you know, on my right, you know, it would be the subject's left eye. And I don't know why I've always done that ever since I was a kid. I just start with the eyes and work my way out, you know. So, but before I do that, just right quick, I wanted to kind of rough in her hair, her head, and just kind of make sure I'm staying within certain guidelines. Let me get this picture. That'll stay. Right there. And again, these can always be erased later on. I may have to continue this later if the thunderstorm that's approaching gets too bad and we get disconnected, which would be sad. But that's the way it goes sometimes. And it's going to be raining all week, so I figured I'm going to go ahead and try it anyway, even though I knew a storm was coming. Now see, the contour of her neck, for example, and her shoulder, there's not actually a line there. You know, there's really no lines in nature. But that's just for a guide. And actually, I'm going to have a continuous shade going there up to this line. I'm trying to see. Oh, that's not even showing up yet. That's how light that is. Okay, let me get a darker. But I did want to just put in those lines, just to kind of, for me, guidelines, so I know where the mouth is and stuff. Okay, that's probably good enough. Okay, now I'll get a darker pencil. Maybe I should start off with that eye. I use an emery board sometimes to sharpen it, if I want a really fine point over the trash can, or you'll get pencil filings all over your carpet. Sometimes you might want to get a cloth and wipe that off. Let's see. Yeah. Okay. We'll just kind of see that. Yeah, it doesn't have to be exact, but you know.
Let's see. Actually, there's a little thing.
Eyes are the most important, in my opinion, on a sketch. You get that right. And the hair, for some reason. You change someone's hair up, they'll almost look like a different person. Got to get the hair and the eyes right. And the nose is pretty important, too. And so is the mouth. I guess they all have their importance. But the eyes, definitely got to get the eyes. Let's see, is that? Yeah, that's showing up. You know, I've never actually even seen any of the Harry Potter movies from beginning to end. That whole thing was happening back when I was in college, and I was just so busy. And so I actually need to try to find some time to do that, to see those. But, you know, I wonder if they're a little too fantastical for me because or a little too nonsensical because, I got to have it, my movies have make at least some sense, like if it's too much like Bed Knobs and Broomsticks, and if there's any of, or Mary Poppins, something like that, that's just completely off the wall. That makes no logic or, no logical sense. I kind of am not drawn to those type of movies, but, they can sometimes be good, but. And, I never was really that attracted to Emma Watson. But I guess it's because she was a little girl. I always thought she was cute, though. But when I first saw this picture and, I was thinking, wow, she's, really starting to grow into a young, beautiful woman. In other words, she's become quite the little hottie potty in her older years. I don't even know if I can talk and draw at the same time, if I can focus. Probably not as well, but we'll find out. Never actually done that before. Let's see. Just got to keep it loosey-goosey. That's what I learned is one of the best secrets in drawing is if you try too hard with every line and you're trying to plan it out too much and you're too stiff about it, then it's going to look too controlled and stiff. But if you try not to be too afraid to mess up. So if you keep it loose, it tends to have a better natural flow to it, the lines do. Let's see. Oh, and just in case, if you're wondering about the glove, that's just, something I do to so I don't smudge or dirty up my paper, and it helps it glide, more naturally. Sometimes, I'll use paper, it just depends. But the thing about paper is it covers it up sometimes part of the picture, and you got to keep moving it and whatever. And I sometimes, we use this to help blend and hypnotize, you know, the pencil lead there. So. The eyebrows, you gotta, or the eyelashes, you gotta put some pressure down and then let up the pressure as you pull away. And remember, don't overthink it, especially with things like eyelashes. You just gotta be confident and go for it. Or to look too stiff and unnatural. Let's see. Okay. I think that's coming in okay. Now I'm going to go ahead and see. Sometimes I'll tape down my paper, but when I'm doing especially a pencil sketch, like if I was doing a watercolor, I'd be taping it down. You normally already have the preliminary sketch for a watercolor, but when I'm pencil drawing, I like to be able to turn it and stuff. Not everybody does, but I do. I like that freedom. I can get a better stroke at certain angles. Don't want to overwork an area either. Got to always be careful not to overwork something. You just keep messing with it and keep messing with it, and it's going to look weird. It'll look overworked. Oh, she's got some mascara on, doesn't she? Some really thick mascara. But it looks good. Not knocking it. And once I get the eyes on the picture, then I feel like the rest is home free. Easy, easy peasy, Japanesey. Might want a slightly lighter. Let me go back to my hard right quick. And sometimes when it's really soft, subtle shading, you get a harder lead pencil and you get a more continuous shade. Because you got to be careful with the softer leads, because easily dig into the paper and create some really dark areas where you didn't want to. Some leads are so soft and dark that you can even use a regular pencil sharpener on them because they're just so gentle, so easy to break because they're so soft. Well, I noticed this, my top picture sure seems to be lagging, but the bottom one, I don't know, it seems to be lagging too. I tested this earlier and it wasn't lagging quite as bad as it's lagging now. I'm not sure why. Maybe that's just for me though, the download speed. Maybe once it's uploaded or fully processed, it won't be so bad. Let's see, is that, yeah. Let's see. Made it darker. Actually, I'm going to wait until I get some more shading because before I start putting in the eyelashes, it's kind of something you want to do at the last, you know, after everything's properly shaded, and because that overlaps, it goes over everything. Let's see. I think I got that. Yeah. Yeah, let me make sure I got that. In fact, I might even use a slightly, use the lightest on this. Oh, and here, I'll show you something here. I always have a piece of paper with me. In fact, I can remove this. This is one of the best tools ever. It's a caliper. I love that. See, there's a lot of them that have a digital readout here, and they're so expensive. And I looked and looked for one that was just a regular manual. You know, it's for, let's see, inside, outside, because these can, like, measure the inside of a pipe, you know, so it can do both directions. But, yeah, it's one of the greatest finds. And I couldn't find any others that were, that was basically as awesome as that one. But, yeah, paper, you know, I sometimes use to test out things, to test out the way it, and to sometimes round off the tip a little bit. And if it takes too long, I'll use sandpaper. Thank you. I remember when I first saw this picture, I actually thought it was a pencil sketch, a line drawing, just the way they shot it, whatever photographer. I'll try to find the name of the photographer who did that. It was really awesome, the way the pure white background and her white dress and everything was, you know, grayscale. Also, as I shade, I try to go in the direction of the shadow, the skin, you know, the form that I'm trying to shade. You don't want to just do straight back and forth, you know, harsh lines. For those of you who are beginners and trying to learn how to draw. A lot of little circular motions and, you know, curvature, curving broad strokes. Let's get that mouth in there. Also, you got to have some confidence that it's going to look like her, because at first, no matter how good you are, a picture will never, you know, look like the person right away. It kind of takes a while to come into focus. Just got to have a little bit of confidence. Don't start freaking out. Yeah, drawing is kind of like being in a kind of almost like a hypnotic state if you're doing it right. You know, you just got to kind of let yourself go. And like I said, don't overthink it. Don't try too hard. Just get into that zone and be a little loosey-goosey, a little free with it. Try to have fun with it. And believe it or not, that usually helps make it look much better than it would have if you were trying too hard. I can often usually tell if somebody just handed me a drawing from someone who was an amateur. I can always see the telltale signs of an amateur, because the strokes always look so stiff and controlled and almost hairy, you know. See, sometimes I hold my pencil at an angle, a very sharp angle. Sometimes, you know, I'll do like this, but every now and then, you know, I'll hold it like that, or, you know, really you know, really, I guess if you look here, very shallow to maximize the area of lead that I'm applying. It's a very subtle line right there. I need to be careful. On young people, even though there are lines there that you can see up close in the photograph, sometimes you want to just dismiss with emphasizing those. You know, be real careful because it'll all of a sudden start to look like an old person, or if it's a female, it'll start to look like a male. There's a lot of weird things that can happen, you know, in very subtle ways if you're not careful. Okay, that's like the main blocking there. I don't like the way that looks. I need to change that. Let's see. Okay, let me hypnotize that, that's just all shade, no lines. I also have these, I think they're called tortillons, twirled up paper for shading, you know. I have all sorts of different sizes I'll show you. See, there's... and then you can sand it down if it starts to build up too much graphite on them. A lot of times I like to just use my fingers, though. I don't know why. It feels like I have more control. Let's see. Now I forget what I was doing. Let's see. I'm going to start blocking in some more of that hair. Now hair, that's another good example where you just gotta go with the flow. I swear, if you try to overthink it, it will not look like hair. It'll look like, I don't know, like a robot's hair or something. It's, you just wanna really be loosey-goosey with that. And you don't try to get every single hair exactly as it is in the source material that you're looking at. That's a big no-no, don't worry about that. Don't try to make sure that hair number 32 is exactly in place. Just try to improvise it. It's just the interpretation of the hair. That's what you're wanting to go for. It's like almost an impressionistic piece here. I've even learned with painting, like when I do oil portraits, I got to really blur up the strokes I do because they look too clean and perfect. And it's like, oh my gosh, I gotta fix that. Now I do try to generally get the direction of hair strokes and the shades. I do try to match that up to some degree. Generally. And remember, it doesn't have to be exact. Exactamundo right on the monkey's butt. Again, so now, right now, I'm really lifting up my hand and trying to do it very lightly. So that way, I can just kind of plan it. And then I'll sometimes put pressure down when I see some really dark areas. And when I think I got it nailed, like right now, a little dark spot there. There's some spots that I might even go back over with something really dark, like a charcoal pencil or something, or even even a marker. I don't know, it just depends. You know, some, there's certain areas that, you know, if they're really dark, like in her eyes, like just super black, or as my drafting teacher used to often say, gorilla ass black, then you can use like a Sharpie pen or some kind of ink pen, you know, India ink or something like that for the pupils to just to really bring out that contrast and make it jump off the page a little. I'm going to switch to a lighter pencil because her bangs towards her forehead get rather light. In fact, I'm going to even stop for just a bit and kind of get her skin tone, just get, you know, the tonality of her skin placed in a little bit. Well, I mean, I can go ahead and plan that. Can do a little more hair, I guess. Yeah. I can see that coming in. Process of just zeroing in on it and bringing more and more focus to it over time. That's the secret. Don't try to finish one spot completely. I mean, some people do that. I never really did. I always kind of worked my way around, jump around, and kind of get an overall look of it, and then slowly bring the whole thing into focus. Where some people might just work on one thing and just really finish that and then move on to another spot and then really finish that and then move on to another spot. I've never generally done that. I'll kind of rough out the whole thing and then just bring it into more focus. But then sometimes there will be a spot where I'm really interested in it and I'll go ahead and finish that one spot as it's getting closer and closer to completion. Then I don't mind doing that. Yeah, she did turn out to be quite the little hottie, didn't she? I didn't see that coming. Then I started finding her attractive. So Emma, if you're watching, call me. If you just need someone to talk to, if you need a friend, everybody needs a friend. I think I'll go ahead and put that up. By the way, see this pencil box? Let me just show you that. I just recently purchased that. That's actually a utility drawer that I got at Lowe's. And I think I saw them being sold at Walmart. And it's made out of bamboo. And it's for the kitchen, like a kitchen drawer for utensils. But it works out great holding pencils and stuff. That little spot right there is very light. It's like she highlighted her hair a little bit, or somebody did. Which is okay. I'm not knocking it. Just saying. I don't know. She probably doesn't have short hair anymore. So this picture is kind of dated. But she may go back to, you know, they go back and forth. You know, I do. Sometimes I have long hair, sometimes I have short hair. And here I'm trying to establish all the main direction of the hair strands. Then I'll go back and really tighten it up a bit. And see, right in the spot right here, it gets a little dark. Nice. watching myself here, it's actually in reverse, so it's a little weird for me. It's been a long time since I've actually timed myself. I'm probably going a little slower than I normally do because I'm talking and I'm trying to do two things at once. But after the streaming is over, then I'll know, you know, how long this one took me. If I don't get disconnected by a storm, that would ruin the results. Now, see, when you go back over areas that you've already put some graphite down, you got to be careful because if you plan to go down with something even darker, if you keep mashing it down with your pencils, you smooth out the texture of the paper, the teeth of the paper, and it'll be hard to sort of accept the darker graphite that you want to apply later on, because you almost polish it and get it too smooth if you keep reworking it. So you got to be careful to know, you know, what not to overwork if you're going to come back with some other layers of darker values. But if you know, if you got an area that's pretty much what it should be and you want to kind of apply some pressure and really almost have that polish effect, you know, some areas can use that, you know, it just depends. So I got to come back and redarken all that. But let me get her ear so she can hear. So she can hear what I'm saying. There we go. There we go. There she is. Let's see. If you want to see some really soft lid, let me show you this. This is compressed carbon. I don't even want to touch it because that's how it's like, almost like ash that I pulled out of a fireplace. Let's see. If you can see that, but I'll go ahead. Yeah, it's literally like, and it's very brittle. I mean, it's very, but there's a big fat stick right there. That's if you just really want to apply a huge area of really dark, charcoal-y, you know, dark tones. Just gotta be careful not to break it. If you almost sneeze on it, it'll break. So. Let's see what am I working in. Let's see, we need something a little darker. So here's a good example of what I was talking about a while ago. I'm going to go ahead and rework this spot right here and kind of polish that in, because I'm not going to go in there with real dark values or anything. But I want to make it nice and smooth and continuous and really blend it in. So I don't mind reworking that spot so much. kind of been a while since I've done a sketch. So I kind of took a break from art and did a lot of writing. As you know, I don't want art to necessarily be the only thing that defines me. I have other interests. And you get kind of burned out if you do the same thing over and over for a while. So sometimes it's good to just take a break from it and go do something else and then come back to it some years later. Because you don't also want to get burned out on it, you know, get to where you can't stand it. It's kind of like we love tacos, but if you have tacos every day, it finally gets old. And you actually kind of can lose your skill a little bit. It's almost like you need to kind of walk away from it for a while. There's all kinds of interesting little canals in the ear in there. It's amazing. Nature usually knows what it's doing. Not always, but usually. Let's see this. Now I'm going to just do like that to give it some shade. I'm going to use the existing lead on the page to kind of create a tonality for her skin. Blur that in. And it'll start to look more and more natural. Sometimes people like to leave the strokes very apparent so it, you know, looks like a pencil sketch even from a distance, because that's just their style and nothing wrong with that. So let's see. I'm using hard lead again because I want just a light tone there that I can carefully blend in later. Again, if you use too soft of a lead, you'll accidentally put too much pressure in and you'll create these little areas that are just like a little too dark. So she has, it's hard to see, but she has like a little dark spot right there. Just a little bit of a, and we'll try to craft that a little later more, you know. But right for now, I'm going to just kind of indicate it roughly. And I don't know if you can see, but up close, this, you can actually see where the shading takes the contour of her, the form of her eyes and so forth. It actually follows these interesting little curves. So it's not like just coloring like this, you know. You'll be in trouble if you do that. Almost feel, act like you're actually creating her skin and follow it. Now here it gets a little darker, so I'm going to apply a little more pressure. And even it's a little, you know, she's got some freckles there, so I'm going to even, you know, put a little more pressure here and there to kind of create that differentiation. Oh, y'all can't, that doesn't really translate that well through there. It's just darker for me when I'm watching. But it'll get darker here in a little bit because I will make it darker. It's 8:30. So far, I've been doing this for about an hour. You know, the other thing, you know, I cut these, you know, I cut the you know, this off, of course, so I can have more control over my pencils. But, you know, I keep these, you know, little parts that I cut off so I can keep my little finger warm. Just kidding. But what I use them for is, like, if I want to just use one of them for, you know, shade with, you know. All kinds of little tricks. Every artist has their tricks. This jawline is actually tricky because light catches it right here. I don't know if y'all can see that. Maybe using my bigger ones. See that, how light catches it right there? So you want to leave that alone. Don't draw over that, but just sketch this part down here and fill that in, and then fill the shading in over here, and then that light will naturally show itself. And I might even have to go back with an eraser to reinforce it, which is okay. Because I'll need to kind of draw a little something just so I know where certain things are. And see the stroke I'm having to do here and the way I'm holding this. I'm holding it further back and using this, you know, motion here, trying to get that, you know, that radius there. I'm starting to apply a little more pressure here. You know, I actually learned that beautiful women and babies' faces, they're actually the hardest because they're so smooth, and, you know, when they look so beautiful and so perfect, the slightest error and imperfection really shows. You know, like you can paint an old man, you know, with all the wrinkles and everything, and it's easy to, you know, no one's going to notice if you mess up. So you can get away with a lot when you're doing an older person, and there's a lot of detail. In fact, it can make a bad artist look like a good one. But try doing a smooth baby face or a woman's, you know, a very young woman. That's hard to do. So if I accomplish this, I'll be proud. I better not to almost rework that area too much with the hard lead. I need some much softer. In fact, I'll get some really soft lead here. I will get a 8B. Yeah, just to show you. And I'll really lay it in. And she's got dark eyes. Lovely dark eyes. So far, I don't hear the thunderstorm, so far I've been lucky. There's my dark boy. There he is. And I'll probably come back with something really dark towards the very end to really make all this pop here. Now here I'm going to rework this to really kind of smooth this out a little bit, just a little bit. Might need to hold off a little bit here. Yeah, one of the reasons why I had trouble with, you know, certain films like Bedknobs and Broomsticks is because a film has to be good enough for me to want to suspend my disbelief. Like we all know that Superman can't fly, but we're all willing to suspend our disbelief because in the story they do a good enough job of giving me at least some logic, you know, that he comes from another planet and they can do that. And so they give me something to hold on to. And I just wonder if Harry Potter is too, you know, nonsensical, but, you know, I don't know because I've never watched one from beginning to end. I've watched the first one And I think from beginning to halfway or something, and then I don't know, I had to go study or something. But I don't know if I remember if it, if I liked it or not. But I mean, it seemed like it didn't seem to make a whole lot of, you know, that there wasn't a whole lot of logic there to hold on to. And that kind of, you know, when magic is involved, you know, there's a lot of margin for, you know, a lot of wild cards where anything goes, anything can happen. And maybe that's one thing I have an issue with, where I don't want too much magic. And I actually love mythology, actually. So if someone can just find that nice balance of, you know, mysticism and magic, but don't go overboard. But maybe Harry Potter, the people that, what's her name, who wrote the Harry Potter stories, maybe she did a really good job of staying within that balance. I'd have to find out. If any of y'all know, let me know in the comments section what you think about the Harry Potters, actually. Whether you recommend it to me or if I should pass and not waste my time. Maybe it was just a fad, a generational fad kind of thing. You know, like kind of like the Twilight movies. Seems like every few years there's kind of a new, you know, craze of, oh, and then there was the, you know, the Lord of the Rings, that too. I actually read the Hobbit when I was in, it was either junior high or high school. I think it was junior high. It was the first book I ever like really read. And our teacher allowed all of us to choose one book from a huge list. And somehow I got lucky enough to choose, you know, to get the Hobbit. Because once somebody chooses a book, nobody can choose that book. And somehow I got the Hobbit. And that was like the perfect book to be my first book to read all the way through as a kid, to get somebody interested in reading. And I just really enjoyed that. So if the Harry Potters or anything like, you know, like that, you know, then I'd love it. Females are hard to draw because it's so easy to make a mistake and make them look ugly. So I got to really, you know, in the end, and really make it look elegant, because that's what she looks like in this picture. She looks elegant and young.
Well, pressed down just a little too hard there. I'll have to erase that a little bit, maybe. I've had pictures where it just will not look like them until I finally put in the hair. Because that's how, you know, important their hair was for that particular person. Like, especially like if they had long hair. It's like Gene Simmons won't look like Gene Simmons until his hair is put in. It's a little darkened right there. Very subtle though. I'm gonna really start trying to put in some tones here. So I'm getting a little, probably a little behind, going a little slow. I need to get to it. I don't want this to be a 4-hour video. Thank you. I hate when my desk moves back and forth like that. Makes me want to cry. I need to get that somehow stabilized. It's got a broken leg, basically. She has like this little doily, beautiful doily dress. And I don't really want to draw the lines of it because it's really just the tonality of her skin that makes the outline of it. But I got to draw a little something to help me guide her later on. And I can soften those up later. Yeah, something like that. It's kind of hard to see some of that. It's coming slowly but surely. I'm gonna start fading that in. You know, sometimes artists, you know, I don't have my stick with me, but they'll use like a dowel, a stick, and keep their hand off of it. Especially, you know, I have one that I made with a little cushy thing that I made out of some old material, you know. A little thing wrapped around it, so it's like a little cushy ball of material that you can rest on your painting or whatever and keep your hand off of it and do all kinds of stuff. I do it when I'm painting because the painting, the easel is upright and I need to get in there and steady my hand and move around. So that works best. The hand, the glove thing's not going to work because when you're working in oils, the whole thing's wet, so you can't touch it at all, whether you have it on an easel or on a desk. If you have it on a desk, your clothes will drape over it and stuff. So you just really need to have it on an easel usually, or at least maybe something in between, and, you know, use that to render or paint with. Tricks of me trade. Tricks of me trade. Not just mine, though. Of course. I have tricks, though, and little secrets, you know, little things that I know that I do. Another thing I'll show you is, you know, drafters use this, but I took a drafting course, but ever since I really like this thing. It's called a dry cleaning pad. It's filled with eraser fillings, little tiny particles of eraser material, kind of like when you erase something, that those little particles. So it almost looks like a sock. And so whenever your image gets like this almost imperceptible film of lead from rubbing around on it all day or whatever as you've been working it, you can take this and clean up that film without ruining your artwork too much, you know, without erasing, because it's so gentle and it does it in a more harmonious way than if you took like an actual eraser, and tried to specifically, like even fat erasers, it wouldn't matter. It would
it would show the lines of erasing. In fact, I've done a whole portrait one time where I intentionally sprinkled pencil lead and coated a page, and I used nothing but an eraser to put in the highlights. And so you create a whole image like that. Even when I'm trying to blend this in, I'm still trying to go with the contour and form of her skin, because that all constantly helps to create that. Disk again. Coconut milk for nourishment. Here's another little drafting tool, a little thing that I learned in drafting. If I can get it, a little brush here. Love this. Drafters use this all the time. That took about 4 semesters of drafting. That was very helpful. Really teach you a lot of different things that an artist can use, how to draw lines and how to, all kinds of little technical things that came in handy later on, and how to measure things out properly. So. Okay, now what? I think I want to darken some of that hair there. I've also noticed that just darkening someone's hair can make it look more like them. They're really weird. All these little things that bring a portrait to life. Yeah, so if you're drawing for the first time, don't get discouraged until the very end. Because who knows, all that needs to be done is darken the hair, and then all of a sudden it'll look like them. Going to a 3B because I want a slightly smoother look. The darker lead, the softer lead, is a little too granulated looking. You know. There, that's getting some darker values there. That's what we need. Once I can get the hair, then I can start working my way down with the darker values. Instead of up, because once you have darker values here and your hand starts moving up and touching it, you smear it. And so it's always kind of good at this point to maybe work your way down. Just making it up as I go now. See how it sounds like I know what I'm talking about? I'm kidding. I know a little something. I know a thing or two about a thing or two. I should get some really dark stuff happening down here. Didn't see that before. So I put a lot of pressure in the beginning and then lift up as I progress the stroke, and it gets thinner and thinner. It has a kind of helps give it that the look of hair. So you don't want the same line weight all the way through, or it won't look natural. Thank you.
That's really light up in there. Gotta be careful. See, I'm just gonna kind of make this up. I'm not gonna pay attention to every little stroke of hair that she has. No artist could. Unless he was psycho. And it might be possible. I'm going to use some of that graphite that's on my finger now to kind of shade in her little temple there. Sometimes I do stuff like that. Instead of actually shading it in with a pencil, I'll come over here and grab some of that and give her some blush there. It's starting to come in. I've also noticed that, especially with females, that once you you gotta almost wait until you put on the, almost like what you would think of as the makeup, the thick eyeliner and the, you know, mascara and all that. Oh, wait a minute, I wanted to do this first. Let's see, what do I got? To be or not to be? Let's see, I guess I'll try that one. Try the H, hard. And see, I want to do that. If it was taped down, I wouldn't be able to do that. I'll smooth it all out too, a little more later. Trying to match the tonality there. Collarbone or clavicle. I think I might create a speed painting version of this portrait. I'd like to pull that back a little bit. Let's see. I'll try this. And I think that was just a little too far out. The neck is a little more pulled in than right there. Thank you. Trying to find out where that other clavicle is. For some reason, it's time to probably supposed to wait a little longer before doing this portion because now I got to go back up here and work it, but got a little impatient with seeing how that was turning out. A little worried. I kind of rushed it because I'm trying to hurry and finish it. She's starting to come into focus now. It's getting to be more delicate work here. Need to shade it darker. You'll start to notice things along the way, what you need to shade darker, what you need to lighten up, what you might even need to erase and redraw. Got a cute little chin. So,
I have the chat turned off on this because I was worried that I wouldn't be able to concentrate if people were trying to chat with me. But I might do that in the future. Probably spent too much time on all the light sketching. I was just trying to show those who are beginners and interested in learning how to draw some of the steps. So normally I would have gone, you know, a little darker, a little sooner. Sometimes if you do see lines where you don't want to see them, just slightly change direction and it'll start to help it blend in better. You'll never get the tonality exact, you know, but just try to get it close. Pull my chair up. Very subtle lines in her neck, so I don't want to accentuate that too much, but just a little to give a little neck, you know, impression that there is a neck there and texture. So if it looks too continuous, then it'll start to look like a cartoon, and we don't want that for this. See, it starts to lighten up over here, which means she had a little more lighting somewhere over there. You can see it hitting her face a little bit. Back over here. Mm-hmm.
don't want to get this too dark, but I do need to increase that darkness just a bit. Slowly but surely. Nose is a little thinner. That's darker. Thank you. some of that texture that the graphite makes, I want to keep it. I don't want to rub it in too much in certain places. These little things, I don't know what they are, but see how those work. Yeah, that works nicely. Looks like, see, there's a little spot there that I might actually need to use in my bag here, because it just got a little weird. There. Better. Just lightly do that. Oh, that's what did it. Pinky. Something like that. Thirsty. I'm going to try to get into those eyes a little bit more. Make them dark. Gorilla ass dark. Remember, don't overthink the eyelashes. If it doesn't look exact, don't worry about it. Just move on to the next one. One little mistake that does need to be changed. When that happened, that does not do that. It does that. There. Yeah, that looks a little better. Sometimes the littlest things can make all the difference. Is it getting there? We're moving into the fine-tuning stage. A lot of subtle little things. Freckles you want to kind of make up as you go, but there are certain ones, if they're prominent, and you know, go ahead and try to put those in. Just a little bit. Just wanted to enhance that just a wee. So, boy, that keeps getting weird looking. Like, I'm not going to use my kneaded eraser. I have lots and lots of different kinds of erasers. There's this, which is like some kind, it's called art gum eraser. I've never really used that. And then there's the white eraser, which is, you know, really good for getting dark lines. And then there's this, which you can use with also pastels and chalk pencils, which is kneaded eraser, and you can change its shape. If I can open it fast enough. Let's see, where's my blade? This will use a pair of scissors. Oh, there's my blade. Oh, let me show you my other calipers. These right here. There's, you know, you can, like if you're sculpting, you know, you get the distance of something. Or if you need to know the eyes, where something is, and then you scale it up, you know, using a ruler, of course, and then you'll know if you're at least within the ballpark. So. It was a little stiff. My other ones aren't so stiff. Let's see. I don't want to cut myself on live feed here and bleed to death. Hopefully one of y'all will call the paramedics if I pass out. Yeah, see, and then you can just tweak it and get into some really tight areas. Change its shape like that. And it's also a little, can be a lot more gentler. So, like you can just sit there and pat it. Say boom, 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 there. See how that's taking that away? In fact, it's even kind of creating a cool little texture. I think I'll keep doing that. So you always discover things when you're doing art, just what works and what doesn't. I think I need that, yeah. Oh, that really works. It's been a while since I've used that. It's just like a, it's almost like bubble gum. I don't know how to describe that if you haven't ever seen it. It's almost like Play-Doh, like a clay, like a crossbreed between an eraser and clay. Imagine that there was a teleporter accident with, you know, those two things. That's what you would end up with. Something like that. All right, see how she's definitely got some darker shades though, but I'm building up is what I'm doing, just over time, building up more and more. And that's the process. Let's see, what should I use now? I wonder if I should use a, it's a little scary to, you know, use a matte pencil or a colored pencil because that's much harder to erase and it's more permanent. But you can get a lot darker things happening. So in areas that I'm absolutely certain of, I'll try that a little bit to really see it gets it really nice and dark. And sometimes I'll try charcoal. But I kind of don't want the charcoal to smear in other areas. So to get greater contrast, I'll maybe just use this matte pencil. Yeah, if you make a mistake on this, it's harder to erase. It's just a little scary. Yeah, I see, getting the darker values in there. Well, I've been gone for 2 hours now. I need to wrap this up. If I can't finish it in time, I'll at least finish it and then use that for the thumbnail so that y'all could see the finished product. Well, I guess so far the storm did not come. I don't know how that happened. I guess I got lucky. I needed a little luck lately. Just definitely want some key spots to be really dark. Like my drafting teacher used to say, gorilla ass dark. They used to make a friend of mine, me and a friend, my table partner, we used to laugh so hard at that. Because a gorilla's ass is pretty dark. I mean, I'm assuming. I don't think I've ever actually seen one, but I'm. Let's see. Is that music getting on anybody's nerves? Just let me know in the comments. Every now and then it's getting on mine, but I know it's kind of peaceful, but it's just that it's gotten kind of repetitive. The other thing that's great about colored pencils is it doesn't smear so easily. So if you finally hit that point where you're tired of it smearing, because it causes you to lose some fine detail, just start with the colored pencil and you'll be good to go. Now I think I'm going to start using a very dark pencil, so I don't want to get crazy with the color pencil just yet. I'm not that confident. But just a few more strokes. Tell you what, I get a little, for the eyes, get a little ink, show you that. And I also have another pen here from my graphic design days. One is just, that's the one I'm going to show you. But this one's just like really super tiny, the nib, for like really fine work. So very tiny. I might need that, but this one, the nib, is like a it's like a paintbrush, but yet it's not, there are no bristles, but it's a flexible nib and ink comes out of it, so it's nice and flexible. So I'm going to be brave enough to use that on the pupils and maybe the eyelashes. To really darken it up. I might even have to go back over it with some pencil lead if it gets too dark. Yeah, because she got some dark eyes. Beautiful dark eyes. I think I will go in with a colored pencil to go over that, to finish that out, to blend that in more. That was dark, wasn't it? Let's see, might even, no, I'll wait on that. Don't want to get overconfident with that. Have to use that stuff sparingly. Oh, wait, I know what I wanted. A colored pencil. Make that girl's eyes dark. There we go. That's starting to happen. That's where we're at. See how that can make all the difference? Just needed to get some darkness in there. I mean, we're talking emo dark. Well, we know how dark emos are. We'll go back over the eyelashes, I mean, just to smooth that out, that transition. I knew Emma was in there somewhere. And her eyebrows need it too, because she does have some nice dark eyebrows. Let me try the darker, just simply the darker lead for the eyebrows and see if that does it. So I don't want to do it too dark. Yeah, that should do it. I think I need to really accentuate that line. And believe it or not, the whites of people's eyes can be very shaded. It's actually surprising how shaded they actually are, even though they look like they're supposed to be white. Again, the right thickness. Okay, I went just a little too far on that one while ago. I have to fix that. Now then there. I don't know if this is work. Got a little too much there. Just a wee bit. Yeah, it is working. Let me do. I just recently bought that, some kind of weird eraser. Wow, that does work. I picked it right up. Yeah, I made the eye just a wee too big there. And then that was just a wee too dangly. There. Yeah. May have to turn this into a part two, like a two-parter. This is taking too long. Let's see. Yeah, I think I... Thank you. Seems like no matter how dark the lead is, it's never quite as dark as a colored pencil or ink. They need to invent a really dark pencil. Trying to go in and do all the final shading now. If this wasn't recording the whole time, wouldn't it be sad? I'd cry myself to sleep. Hey, it may not have. You never know. I have the worst luck with technology sometimes. I'll just have to do it again. That's how that works. Got a little more darkness in the eyes, that sultry look, very dark eyes, so we're going to start darkening that up some more. She was so emoed out that day. I like the emo look. Even though it was cool. I think I'm going to do just a little more shading on this and then maybe either make a part two or just show the thumbnail at the end after I get that finished. Let's see if I can do it again. Let's see. I'll know how to do this quicker next time for stream time. At least I think I will. I will try to do it a little quicker. I didn't realize I had talked so much and worked so slow. You know, they ought to make these pencils to where the color of the pencil is the tonality of the hardness or softness. That way I don't have to keep looking at the bottom to see if it's 2B or 2H or H, HB, whatever. Maybe one day somebody will think of it. I mean, think of it and actually execute it. Just a little bit. So now I'm kind of doing the opposite with my eraser, the opposite of shading, trying to bring in some highlights where they should be. Just go back and forth till we get it and help put in some skin texture. Thank you. These parts get kind of subtle, very sensitive. Very sensitive to potential mistakes. And Watson, she's trying to come through. I'd even use some watercolor to really darken that. Watercolor pencils, maybe, about that. Just to really help that contrast. And the dress here, she just has all these little cute little doily shapes. So I'll do a little bit of that for you. Just fill in these little ovals to give the impression of a very ornate. Doesn't have to be exact, of course. Don't try to copy every exact little wrinkle and, you know, it's like a little doily thing. Just try to give the impression of it. Think of it as impressionistic work. I mean, try to, you know, some of it you can try to do, but know where to draw that line where it starts to get ridiculous. Yeah, I'll show you that up close. Let's see. You know, the doily there. That's what I'm trying to get. In fact, let me look at that. That's easier to see now. I know Google Hangout or whatever is supposed to allow me to record 8 hours. I don't actually want to go 8 hours because I need to sleep and do other things. So every now and then there's some really large shapes there. Yeah. Just gonna make it up. I think for that, I'm going to go with a really hard lead. Just really get that smooth as silk. We'll try that. We'll try the 4H. Now here you can kind of pick up the pattern a little more, so I got to be a little more careful, at least somewhat. I'll still keep it loosey-goosey though, and not overthink it. See, that's kind of looks like a flower thing happening there. And since it looks pretty, I'm going to try to keep it in there. I've learned that you really need to buy the most expensive equipment if you really want to do it right and really create good artwork. I'm totally kidding. That's actually not true at all. You could actually produce a great work of art using a cat turd. So I sometimes though, you know, I try to get good equipment, good supplies. But, you know, you could do a lot of great things with mediocre supplies, so you don't have to buy the most expensive stuff there is. Never let anybody tell you that, because they would be wrong. Oh, there's a huge spot right there. I think you get the idea. Well, it's about to be 11 o'clock. I think what I'll do is I will continue to work on this and get that shading down and maybe show it as the thumbnail. So that way, I almost would like to work on that a little more, but it's just taken so long to get all that shading in. That'd take another hour for sure. See, I've started at around almost 8 o'clock, 8 to 9, 9 to 10, about 2.5 hours. Let me go ahead and
assign it. So I have witnesses. Trying to determine where that's going to come in. Just like that. And then I'll finish out. And I'll turn that into the thumbnail. But you get the idea. Oh, I do need to get that eraser. Let me do that real quick. But yeah, you get the idea. I should show you my... Before I go, I should show you my studio, if I could switch that over just a little bit. Let me see if I can do that. Let's see. Oh, and here's a further back. Yeah. And then here is, there's my, maybe I should pull back. Let me showcase my place. See, there's the camera. I cheated, and the mic. Oh, gotta have a mic. But yeah, I figured that was the best place to put it. Some people put it off to the side. I think I might do that too on some, especially if I have an easel and I'm doing some paintings, because I'm gonna do some paintings, both some speed paintings and live feeds, so you can see me do them. I see the process of that. Oh, and do you see my vintage snap together model of Spider-Man, 1978 vintage Spider-Man? That was a same type of model that my dad bought me when I was a kid. And so it's about, I don't know how old it is. I mean, that one's new, though, because I bought one, because I don't know what happened to the original. I probably lost it, or it got broken or something. But anyway. Switch. There she is. Okay. So I guess I will sign off and stop the broadcast and see how all that went. That was now 11. It's now 11:02 my time, 11:02 p.m. So hopefully I can get it looking close to this after I'm finished, or close enough. Let's hope. All right. If you stayed all the way to this point, thanks for watching. I guess I'm going to sign out. Adios.